Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 29th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. The principal item on our agenda this morning is to consider a recent Audit Scotland report into Scotland's public finances, challenges and risks. And so can I welcome our witnesses this morning, Fiona Diggle, who's manager at Audit Scotland, Richard Robinson, who's a senior manager at Audit Scotland, and the Auditor General. You're very welcome. I'd also like to welcome Liz Smith, who joins the committee this morning for this part of our agenda, and we will all have a series of questions to put on the briefing. But first of all, Auditor General, I'd like to invite you to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. We have previously reported on the financial sustainability challenges facing the Scottish public sector. These challenges have been worsened first by the COVID-19 pandemic and now by the cost of living crisis. We are seeing record inflation, high energy costs, falls to real earnings and higher operating costs for public bodies. The Scottish Government faces a combination of an inflation-diminished budget, increased costs and unresolved demands for higher public sector pay deals. It needs to carefully manage its financial position to avoid overspending in its 2022-23 budget. Overspending this year could be clawed back from next year's budget, exacerbating existing pressures on public spending. The challenges facing the Scottish Government are set to continue into next year, and there are difficult choices, therefore, when setting the 2023-2024 budget, as there is limited financial flexibility available to the Scottish Government. It will therefore have to take the UK Government decisions on tax and spending into account. A balance must be struck between short-term necessities and longer-term priorities, and the Scottish Government may need to revisit its priorities should the economic and fiscal position worsen. Given the financial challenges facing the Scottish Government, my report highlights the need for the pace and scale of public sector reform to increase. Past attempts at reform have seen a gap between ambition and actual delivery, and it is vital that future reforms are delivered effectively and with public engagement to deliver financial sustainability, future sustainable services that improve people's outcomes. Convener, as ever, my colleagues and I look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Auditor General, for setting the scene. And we have quite a number of questions into the areas that you've already identified as being quite critical to the assessment that you have made. The first thing I just wanted to ask you is about the timing of the briefing. Obviously, the briefing came out prior to the 17th of November Chancellor of the Exchequer's autumn statement. So I guess my first question is, why produce it prior to that statement, and why not produce it rather than produce it after the statement had been delivered?
I think, Convener, you and the committee will recognise that there's been a huge amount of volatility in the fiscal environment over the past few months, with notable changes in the timing of UK government public fiscal events. So we plan our work many months in advance and look to capture as many of the relevant events as possible. So when we set our publication date for this paper, there was a degree of coincidence that it coincided with the latest UK government fiscal event. I should say it won't be the last statement that we make on fiscal matters, and we'll capture that as part of our rolling programme, or looking at the fiscal sustainability of the Scottish Government as part of our programme into next year.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. Well, can I turn to the autumn statement now and perhaps ask you if you've got a view on what difference you think the key points made by the Chancellor in the autumn statement make to any conclusions that you've made in this briefing that we're considering this morning?
So I think it's perhaps difficult to draw definitive conclusions yet. We've seen as part of the autumn statement, and I'll bring colleagues in a moment with some of the additional detail as they wish. The challenges facing the Scottish Government will continue to exist alongside the impact of the autumn statement. The Scottish Government still has to resolve many of the pressures in terms of public sector pay deals. It will still be facing significant challenges around energy costs, and also the cost of living through the inflation rates will have a significant bearing on what it means for the government's purchasing power and its obligations. We touched on the paper, for example, about the government's requirement to reference inflation rates alongside the uprating of social security benefits. That's going to still have an impact on its budget for next year. In terms of a couple of specifics, the Chancellor made reference to £1.5 billion of Barnett consequentials in his autumn statement. We're looking for the detail of that, as I'm sure the government themselves and some of the economic interests and advisers too. So it's difficult to be definitive yet, convener, about what that means for what that flows through to the Scottish Government's own budget. If I may, I'll pause for a minute and just to check with colleagues if there's anything that they wish to add. Just check with Richard. Thank you.
So I think the first point to make is the contents of the budget don't change the challenges that are in this paper. The challenges remain. What it does do is give it a little bit more of a context about the environment into which the Scottish budget will be set on the 15th. So a couple of things the Auditor General touched on. Spending, what we've seen from the UK autumn statement is what the Scottish Parliament Information Centre recently described as a bit of a game of two halves when it comes to spending growth. There's £1.5 billion which will come through Barnett consequentials expected over the next couple of years before a tailoring off effectively of the increases thereafter. So what that means is that that there is more Barnett consequentials coming through, but as the Scottish Government has already mentioned, as included in the paper, there's also the inflationary effect of the buying power of that money to bear in mind. The second brief point to make is just around income and funding. There are devolved taxes now. They're the largest rich of Scottish income tax. There have been some changes of late at a UK level, which the Scottish Government will also have to decide how to respond to, because that will affect the overall size of the budget envelope.
OK. I mean, can we look at the Barnett consequentials element of this? Because I think you make the point in the briefing that if there is additional help that the Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament wishes to allocate to alleviate the cost of living crisis, it will need to find it from its own resource rather than necessarily or even at all relying on Barnett consequentials. Could you perhaps elaborate that a little bit more?
Yeah, I'm happy to start on that, actually, and Richard might wish to say a bit more about the nature of the flow of Barnett consequentials and if the committee would find that helpful, how that operates. But you're essentially right, convener, in your description that for reserved, for devolved matters, rather, if the decisions rest with the Scottish Parliament and they choose to make additional spending, as they have done so, and our briefing paper refers to some operations where the Scottish Government have chosen to do that, such as cost of living support, some additional energy efficiency matters, references to bridging payments for young people in receipt of free school meal arrangements, are some of the decisions that the Scottish Government can take themselves. But you're right, that has a bearing and has to be funded from their own budget. For spending matters that the UK government take, if that's on devolved matters, there is a flow of funds. But what that might not mean is that it's clear, and I think, as we touched on in our earlier answer, we're still waiting for the detail of the £1.5 billion and what that specifically will mean for both next year's budget and the year after. But I'll stop, actually, and Richard can come in with some more detail just to elaborate as he wishes.
Thank you. Just briefly, I think Barnett consequentials and the block grant remains a key part of the Scottish Government budget. what the one of the points is here, I suppose, and maybe a good way is to contrast it to COVID-19 and the COVID-19 finances that we brought reports to you. Many of the areas of spending in reaction to the crisis were in devolved areas, which meant that they were in the airflows of bonded consequentials through four areas, such as health being a predominant one, elements of education, etc. As we point out in the report, the responses so far to date for the cost crisis at the UK government have been in reserved areas, which means that there's no necessary flow to the Scottish budget, even though it applies to people in Scotland, such as the energy support and relief. So one of the issues around that, the extent to which the Scottish Government must manage its in-year position from the resources that it has available from its existing funding. So we saw within the COVID-19 that there were elements where fresh funding effectively was coming through, and that was able to then be deployed to new events. Within the cost crisis to date, what the Scottish Government must do is manage its in-year position very closely, given that there may not be the same type of flow of in-year bonnet consequentials that we've had in recent years.
Okay. I mean, if I go back and look at the report that that you published on COVID-19 spending, I can't remember the figures off the top of my head, but in terms of the proportion, a very high proportion of additional spending that was available to the Scottish Government was as a result of bonnet consequentials, wasn't it?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Fiona may have the numbers to hand. If we don't, we certainly come back in writing. But the relative scale of COVID funding that came to Scotland, the vast majority was as a result of bonnet consequentials. So the Scottish Government reprofiled some of its own spending, where it knew that, you know, as a result of changes in public spending patterns, demand, that there wasn't going to be the same demand. We've talked previously with the committee, examples such as bus travel was one of the, and support for operators was one of the under-subscribed funds that was reprofiled. But in totality, it was a very small percentage of the overall funding, most of which came from bonnet consequentials.
OK, thank you. I'm going to move things on now and invite Colin Beattie to ask some questions. Colin.
Morning, General. The question of public sector wages are obviously a big issue at the moment. There's many demands out there, and some have been met and settled. Others, we have no idea what the end result is going to be. But what is clear is that inflation has wiped something like £1.9 billion in purchasing power off the Scottish Government's budget. Even if all the bonnet consequentials come through and are available to the Scottish Government, it's barely going to offset that. So it seems to me logical that somewhere money is going to have to be found to meet these wage demands, either in part or full. And there's only two ways to do that. Either we cut the budget in different places, or taxes go up. That seems to be fairly starkly the two options that are available, because, as you say, the Scottish Government's got to balance its budget. It doesn't have any leeway in that. And as I also said, the tax base is shrinking, because obviously people will have less disposable income because of the increased energy costs and the cost of living crisis. Therefore, there'll be less VAT spent because people won't be out doing the purchases and so on that they would in normal times. For the UK, of course, the corporate taxes will go down as well, so there'll be pressure on them too. So within that, but the wages are about £22 billion across the public sector, and funding for these deals will have to come out the 2022-23 budget. What are the implications of this, including for budgets in future years? I mean, your briefing here is basically a red flag to remind everybody of the pressures that are coming through and to make sure that they're met. What do you think the implications are in the future years?
You describe the context as we set out in the paper, absolutely, Mr. Beattie, that unresolved public sector pay deals. And if, just to add on alongside that, the growth, a significant growth in energy costs are both unresolved. So we know that the energy costs are anticipated to rise further into early 2023, and that there are as yet still industrial disputes, discussions around public sector pay. If these are resolved this financial year, they'll have to be met from public funds that are within the 22-23 budget. And in the expectation, as is typically the case, pay awards are consolidated. So they're not a one-off pay award to see public workers through the current year, then are added to the baseline that's applied into the next financial year. So that will all have to be factored into the Scottish Government's 23-24 budget setting arrangements for next year. And to agree again, that as you, the context that you describe about the choices that the government will have to make next year, public expenditure pressures, demands will be met either through taxation arrangements or through finding efficiencies in existing public spending. The efficiencies point, as we set out in the paper, there are flexibilities. Any government can make different choices into the medium and longer term. It's much harder to do that in the short term. So finding the levers that the government will want to will be much harder. And that's effectively what we look to set out in this paper, both that there are in-year financial pressures, as we look to be quite clear that perhaps for the first time since devolution, the Scottish Government faces a real risk of overspending against its budget, and that some of the spending choices available as the Parliament will consider the budget in the next couple of weeks and in the months beyond is that there is going to be a very difficult fiscal environment in 23-24.
I think everybody would agree about the difficult fiscal environment. I mean, at this point, there is no reason to believe, and tell me if you think otherwise, that the Scottish Government is not going to have a balanced budget. The budget has been balanced every year since 1999. So there's no reason to think that they won't take steps, however unpleasant. They have no choice. They have to balance that budget. It's not a choice. It's not an option for them. And there's no reason to think that they won't do that.
So I think really the purpose of our paper was to highlight that this is a very real risk, rather than say that there's no expectation, because I think there is a risk that that would be the case this year. That's not to say the government isn't taking action. If you look at, again, as the paper touched on, and I'll bring Fiona in a moment, just to see some of the steps that the government is taking this year. So totality, they have identified £1.2 billion of spending that through the emergency budget review, just to see what levers are available to the Scottish Government in year. But what that doesn't do is address, as you started with, that there are still very significant unresolved costs facing the Scottish Government in terms of public sector pay. And yes, of course, the energy costs, given the volatility that's happening in the wider world. I'm going to pause, Mr. Beattie, and just bring Fiona in just to say a bit more for the committee's interest in some of the levers that the government have used already. Fiona.
Yes, that's right. Thank you, Auditor General. The Scottish Government has been developing its strategy for financial sustainability over the last year, and the work is aiming to better understand the fiscal risks across the whole of the Scottish Government, and starting to improve the data that's available to them. And for this to work, it will be important that it's transparently shown to improve the scrutiny of the financial position and highlight those risks as early as possible.
Okay. Let me move on to something slightly different. Exhibit 1 in your briefing states that councils currently spend around £86 million on food each year, mainly for school meals and in care settings. Now, it's estimated that food costs are going to increase by 5% over the next 2 years. Where did that figure come from? I mean, it seems, given what we're seeing in the press, it seems a bit unlikely it's only going to be 5%.
Fiona, do you have the detail on that?
Absolutely. These figures came from a response to the Finance and Public Administration Committee's consultation over the summer from COSLA and SOLIS and SITFA. But as you say, these figures have been moving. It's a very fast-moving environment, and those figures may have changed since then.
Now, already we understand that there's a joint letter from COSLA, SOLIS, SITFA and Finance and Public Administration Committee saying this money no longer reflects the actual cost of delivery. So we've heard about the challenges that children living in poverty already have. We know there's a huge percentage go to bed hungry every night, 25% or thereabouts. So that school meals as such are vitally important for those that fall into that category. What priority is being given to ensuring that the level of funding stays sufficient in this area, given what we've said about 5% over the next 2 years, which sounds a bit light, but also about the fact that already they're saying that the money doesn't really cover it?
I'm happy to start again and bring colleagues in again as they wish. I think the point about 5% is probably illustrative of the real volatility of change in costs. You know, even going back to when the Scottish Government set its budget for this financial year, you had an inflation assumptions of around 3.5%, I think is the figure that we refer to in the paper. And then, you know, with CPI in double digits, RPI higher, and then the differential rates of inflation that exist. So I think the point you make is absolutely right, Mr. Beattie, that for some families, as well as public bodies, is that we're not all experiencing the same inflation rates. And if you are on a low income and most of your budget is either spent on energy or food, then you will be experiencing additional hardship. Therefore, it matters all the more that public bodies are able to do all they can to support and prioritise, I think is the point you make, to help mitigate that. So we've seen, and we've touched on already this morning, about some of the steps that the Scottish Government has taken in terms of bridging payments for free school meals, alongside initiatives that are going on in parts of the country about using public buildings as a place of warmth for people. And I think it's also important to highlight, as touched on in the paper, last month now, the implementation of the extension of the Scottish Child Payment as one of the measures to help mitigate some of the effects of the cost of living crisis. Ultimately, it will be about prioritisation, both for central government bodies, the Scottish Government, and for local authorities in Scotland to decide what they can do. But I think it probably speaks to the wider point, is that while many of the costs are fixed, and certainly for central government bodies in Scotland, they don't have access to borrowing arrangements that Scottish local authorities do that may be used. But setting aside the rights or wrongs of borrowing for revenue purposes, as this would be, ultimately this will come down to really steep prioritisation for both the Scottish Government and local authorities about what steps they can and choose to make to offset some of the real cost of living challenges.
Clearly, you touched on the fact that both the government and councils will be looking to provide some sort of safety net for those that are most vulnerable and most going to be impacted by what's happening round about us. Just to broaden out from the question of school meals, your briefing talks about the costs of supporting people through the crisis and that's increased. And you say that social security spending is a key channel which the Scottish Government uses to provide support to individuals, and that 2022-23 it accounted for around 10% of the budget. Now, there's new support being given by the Scottish Government, as you, I think you also touched on, and obviously there's going to be more costs attributed to that. Are you able to give a little more information on that, how you see that developing? Because obviously the anxiety is, with having such a tight and fixed budget that must always be balanced, the inability to borrow, and the fact that we're reliant on private sector taxes to support the whole public sector and the whole of this effort here, how does it come together? How is that support and the costs related to that being handled?
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Beattie. I'll bring Fiona again in a second, just to talk the committee through some of our current understanding. And actually, it's something of a caveat, I think, to many of our response. I think we've heard a number of times already this morning that forecasts, whether they're inflation or public spending, are changing so quickly, given the volatility of the environment that we're in. We expect updated forecasts from the Scottish Fiscal Commission to support the Scottish budget later this month. The most up-to-date numbers, though, we set out on social security spending at paragraph 20 of the paper. It sets out that in the next two financial years, 23-24, 24-25, there'll be an extra £369 million of public spending required to support additional social security costs. Alongside that, the Scottish Government, through the Social Security Act, is required to have reference to the current rates of inflation when setting social security rates for future. So we can clearly, just the scale of change that's already anticipated, likely to be updated further from the Fiscal Commission's forecast, alongside inflation running at double digits. Very clearly, that the 10% that social security spending already consumes of the overall Scottish budget, there remains that possibility that that will require to increase. And as you rightly say, doesn't do away from the fact that the overall budget has to be balanced, and therefore it just points to, again, the Scottish Government will have to make very clear prioritisation, whether it's spending or taxes, to set that balanced budget in future years. I'll stop again, actually, if Fiona, if there's any wishes there.
Thank you. Yes, when the paper published, we mentioned we didn't know what would come in the autumn statement and what the UK government's intentions were regarding uprating benefits. We now know that they intend to uprate in line with inflation for working age benefits, and that will, as we understand it, flow through to the block grant adjustments for those larger benefits that were devolved. But for the newer benefits like Scottish Child Payment, that is entirely funded from the Scottish budget, and no additional funding is provided through the block grant adjustments, and so any will have to be covered by funding from the Scottish budget. We'll know more about the Scottish Government's intentions for uprating benefits when it publishes its paper on this, which I think should be later this month, and also when the Scottish Fiscal Commission publishes their updated forecast alongside the budget in December.
Thank you, Mira.
Okay, thank you very much. Early on in the paper, you quote the Scottish Government's assessment that they face, in their words, significant financial challenges. And Sharon Dowie has got a series of questions which address that. Sharon.
Good morning. Page 9 of the briefing states that without very close management of the budget, there is a real risk the Scottish Government overspends against its 2022-23 budget. Paragraph 24 states early in 2022-23, the Scottish Government was forecasting a significant budget gap for the financial year, which was larger than could be managed through its usual budget processes. Paragraph 25 goes on, the Scottish Government has recognised that the financial situation it faces is by far the most challenging since devolution, and the potential consequences and how this would take shape are unclear at this stage. Can you share your views on what the potential consequences could be and to what extent the Scottish Government might be preparing for this outcome?
So the very real consequence is that for the first time since devolution, the Scottish Government may overspend against its budget. And that event hasn't happened before. You know, it requires a bit of thinking. Well, what does that actually mean? In broad terms, overspends will be clawed back against next year's budget. There's also some reputational risk for the Scottish budget about overspending, given that the budget is fixed and up until now has been managed against those fixed requirements. It is fair to say that, you know, some of the events that have followed since the government's recognition of the significant risk that overspending posed will have gone some way to mitigate that risk. I mean, we've touched on already, and I think as we set out in a bit more detail at Exhibit 2, just over the page, about some of the planned budget changes that the government has set about to offset parts of that risk. In spite of that, I don't think we can sit here in December with, you know, still the best part of 4 months of the financial year remaining that we can say that that risk is entirely mitigated, just given the scale of volatility of energy prices, unresolved public sector pay deals, and rates of inflation that are far, far higher than when the government's budget was first set at the start of 22-23. So I think it's safe to summarise say that steps have been taken, but it doesn't do away with the remaining risk.
Okay, thanks. What scope might there be for the Scottish Government to identify further savings or reprioritisation of budgets to achieve a balanced budget for 2022-23?
I think we can answer that up to a point, actually, and it may be that the government is better placed to share with the committee, you know, should you wish, about some of its additional options and thinking. That they've identified £1.2 billion already, and some of those are quite hard choices and prioritisation mm-hmm. for the government, that they are in areas of significant, you know, policy and parliamentary interest, you know, the employability schemes, mental health support and so forth, that I suppose give an indication that many of the easy choices will already have been made. Some of the difficult ones have already been made, but the levers available to government become harder to exercise, given that most of the budget is already fixed. We've touched already today about the extent to which the budget is staff costs related. The government has committed to a no compulsory redundancy policy as well. And then alongside that, it has unresolved public sector pay deals. So I think all of these just say that there's work still to be done to secure financial balance in the current financial year, recognising that some significant steps have already been taken.
You actually touched on some of the points for my next question. Paragraph 29, bullet point 5, the briefing states that reductions in spending include £53 million in funding for employability schemes, and that £38 million of mental health spending has been reprioritised to support the NHS pay offer. So could you tell us how the £53 million reduction in employability schemes is likely to impact in achieving targets for tackling child poverty, and also whether your future work in adult mental health will consider the extent to which the services have been impacted by the £38 million spending that's been reprioritised?
Yeah, I'll start on that one, and I'll bring colleagues in again in a moment. Perhaps in reverse order, we're in the midst of our work on our audit of adult mental health services in Scotland. We'll be publishing that during 2023. As with all of our audits, we'll consider the funding environment and the budget available to it. Whether it specifically gets into, you know, the changes that £38 million have made in totality against the overall budget, I'll perhaps not be able to be definitive about that this morning, but certainly we'll be looking at the budget and the outcomes achieved from that budget for adult mental health services in Scotland, and we'll be bringing that to the committee next year. In terms of employability schemes, colleagues can maybe say a wee bit more, but certainly our understanding is that identifying that as a potential budget saving, the government was able to attribute the employment rates in Scotland and anticipated demand for employability schemes as being a factor, and then able to offer that up as a saving. Whether that's going to be a consolidated saving, and, you know, that if there's anticipated changes in employment rates, especially as we are in a recession, I'm going to be moving into recession, that's likely to bring further changes in employment rates in the country. So the availability of these schemes will be important that the government weighs that up. You're right, Deputy Convener, we have been doing work on child poverty arrangements in Scotland. What we haven't yet done in the most recent briefing paper was to attribute employability arrangements and what impact that would have. What we did do is to signal our intent to carry out further audit work on child poverty arrangements, and the availability of employment is a key factor in terms of household income and lifting families out of poverty. So it's firmly on our radar for future activity. Again, I'll pause and just check with colleagues if they wish to add.
Just briefly, maybe, I think one of the points there is that it's about there's financial consequences to making decisions, and then there's consequences for people to be considered. And one of the points that we're making in the paper really is about, while these difficult decisions might need to be made, and while they may have some impact on certain groups more than others, is the extent to which people are consulted and aware of the impact of those, and the extent to which the Scottish Government can demonstrate how it could mitigate it where it can, or what the consequences are in a transparent way. And I think one of the things that the paper's bringing through really is that sense of a need for reform over that medium-term picture. So it's not just about whether or not the Scottish Government budget comes in on its budget this year. If it didn't and it was borrowing off the next year, then there's the cumulative impact for then you've got a smaller budget for next year. So one of the points really there is about just demonstrating that need for reform to keep to the medium-term, the RSR. In paragraph 72 to 74, we talk a little bit about what the Scottish Government are doing around that, which includes the Public Spending Portfolio Board, which has been set up to consider how those reforms can come together to ensure that flow of that RSR. And I think this is a critical area to make sure that medium-term position continues to be considered alongside that need for reform in the public sector.
Thank you.
Thanks. I need to refer members to my register of interests, but I wanted to just ask a little bit more about wages and salaries, because it's part of your public sector reform agenda, and you've alluded to it a couple of times this morning already. I mean, economists often look at wages and salaries as a percentage of overall GDP in the economy as a whole, and I just wonder whether you've looked at wages and salaries as a percentage of public expenditure in Scotland, maybe over the last decade. Is it going up? Is it going down? Is it about the same? If you're not able to supply that immediately, if you could follow that up, that would be of great interest, I think. Auditor General.
Thank you, Convener. Very, very happy to come back to the committee with additional detail that we have. By coincidence, Convener, we're having a similar conversation with colleagues earlier this week. It's 10 years now since Audit Scotland published a report on Scotland's public sector workforce. Given the intended, I think, prioritisation that Richard mentioned, the government's resource spending review, and I think it feels timely for us to revisit some of that work. So we're thinking carefully about how and when we best report on Scotland's public sector workforce, given the changes that have happened in the intervening period. You'll not be surprised to hear me say this, Convener, but getting access to high quality data is often a challenge in kind of making some of the overall judgments that we'd want to do so. What is clear, and I think one of the things we'll want to consider really carefully, is that whilst we'll have statistics and numbers about the amount, the percentage of Scotland's public sector workforce, those that deliver services on behalf of the public through public funding is typically far higher than that, as funding through grant will go to voluntary organisations, third sector providers that are just as crucial in delivering public services but won't necessarily be captured in some of the statistics. So we're going to think really carefully how to scope that work, and given how important it will be for public spending and some of the reforms that will be necessary in future. But we can come back to the committee in writing and keep you informed of our thinking on that.
That'd be great. You are well versed in dealing with complicated matters and giving us succinct reports, so thanks for that. Willie Coffey wants to come in. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Auditor General, I wonder if I could draw your attention to paragraphs 13, 14, 15, firstly, in your report. And there's, well, your own opening remarks, you described the budget as an inflation diminished one. And I wonder if you're able to put a figure on that. Now, if First Minister put a figure on it that you've mentioned in paragraph 14 of 1.7 billion. Are you broadly in agreement with that, firstly, at the outset?
So we quote the First Minister, as you say, Mr Coffey, in the paper, £1.7 billion less public spender purchasing power, effectively, as a consequence of some of the really volatile inflation rates that we've all seen and over the past year or so. And really just to repeat some of the comments of earlier, that's not universally felt. You know, so for some families we'll be experiencing a far higher rate of inflation than others, and similarly public bodies. But in terms of the scale of change, 3.5% with some of the inflation assumptions when the Scottish budget was set for 22-23. Current inflation rates, I think our most recent is over 11% for CPI. It will be slightly higher for RPI, and that forecast is anticipated to remain for a while yet as we move into 2023. All of that points to the government's budget is buying less than it was when it was anticipated, and those challenges will remain into
23-24. Mm-hmm. And looking directly at your comments in paragraph 15, Auditor General, that sets out there that the comprehensive spending review was projecting a 3.3% growth, real terms growth in budgets, that's now expected to be 1.9. Is that a further? That's a further expectation of a diminishment, as you put it, of the budget. That's on top of that, then, isn't it?
Yes,
these have you estimated what the value of that might be?
So I'm not sure if I have the detail of that to hand. It's something we may need to come back to the committee in writing with, Mr Coffey, but certainly it's another example of the fiscal environment being incredibly challenging, you know, both in the current year and moving into next year, that public funds, as they currently exist in its current spending plans, will at risk of do less than they were intended to do so when the budget was originally set.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get a flavour, convener, of whether the inflation element plus this diminished spending review percentage is going to be much less than was forecast, added together and then compared with the Barnett consequential that was mentioned earlier of 1.5 billion, where do we end up at? Do we have any idea what we're looking at in totality about the impact on the Scottish budget?
So you'll certainly have a better idea in the next couple of weeks when the Scottish Government presents its draft budget to Parliament. I'm conscious I'm using the word volatility a lot this morning, Mr. Coffey, and I think it's so unprecedented, the circumstances that the Scottish budget is facing. You know, the risk of overspending in the current year, along with the fiscal impact of what that means for next year's budget. You will know more in the next couple of weeks, and especially you'll have updated forecasts from the Scottish Fiscal Commission that will inform through their forecasts what the Scottish Government is able to do to set its budget for next year. And then whatever policy choices, of course, that the government looks to make around taxation and spending to as it sets its priorities for 23-24.
Okay, thanks for that. Turning just to Exhibit 2 there, that you mentioned earlier, there's just a clarification on that part of that, if I may. There's a orange section there that shows £193 million increased income. There's no detail that I can see surrounding that. I just wanted to ask you what that is and where it's came from.
Yeah, Fiona's going to talk you through that. Actually, one of the bullets at paragraph 29 gives a little bit of additional income about some of the receipts that the government has had from ScotWind clearance process and other factors, but Fiona can say more.
Yes, thank you, Auditor General. Yes, that's right. So in September, the Scottish Government announced some additional Barnett consequentials, and there's £82 million there, but also additional income was applied from the ScotWind process. And since then, there's also been smaller additional receipts from capital projects. And
okay, so it clarifies that it's a small drop in the ocean, really. But we're looking for any possible good news in any of this briefing at all. I wonder if I could move on just to ask you about generally about the fiscal framework levers. You mentioned them in the report as well, Auditor General. And they weren't really designed for this scenario, these circumstances. They were meant to just adjust volatility here and there. So what's your impression of the fiscal framework levers? Are they adequate to cover the situation that we find ourselves in? Should there be a revision, a review, a reconsideration of what those levers should do?
Happy to start, actually, and I'll ask Richard to come in and say a bit more about some of the fiscal framework arrangements. I guess a couple of things from me, Mr. Coffey. One is that it is fair to say that the fiscal framework wasn't designed to cope with the level of change that the fiscal environment is having upon Scotland's budget. To all intents and purposes, it was designed to cope with annual volatility in terms of tax receipts, limited borrowing powers to cope with some of those changes in the Scottish Government's spending plans, not as we're currently seeing somewhat uncontrolled energy costs, inflation of double digits and so forth. In terms of my role isn't one to comment upon policy choices. It is for negotiations that are currently in place between the Scottish Government and the UK Government to determine what any changes to the fiscal framework would look like and if there are any successor to that. Of course, Audit Scotland will be keeping close track of that and what the implications might be for future fiscal sustainability arrangements. Before handing to Richard, I think it is, just to repeat if I may, I think it is perfectly fair to say that the framework as it currently stands wasn't designed as for the environment that we're currently operating in. Richard, anything you'd like to add?
Maybe briefly, the devolution of certain taxes and borrowing, etc., alongside the extension of devolution into Social Security, brought with it a whole host of new complications and nuances to manage in the budget during the year. So just to touch on a couple, really. In terms of Social Security, we've touched on already. So it's how the Scottish Government can manage that demand against its policy choices. On taxes, there's decisions that the Scottish Government will have to make about the relative performance of the Scottish income tax and its policies against the UK base, so obviously affected by that there. So these things are within their gift, but there could be difficult decisions. They'll be complex to see how they work through, so we'll see how it works with the Scottish budget and the SFC forecasts. Another complication is, we touched on the CSR just earlier, our understanding is that there's not currently attention at the UK government to come back and do another CSR. So really, for the Scottish Government, managing that medium-term financial position against what's in place is really important. Now, what also would matter is the way in which any additional spending at a UK government is funded. So if it was funded from new borrowing at a UK government level, then that could generate an additional bond, a consequence for the Scottish Government to employ. Having said that, if the UK government increases spending in one area by decreasing it in another, then that won't come through to the Scottish government as a barnet consequential. So what the fiscal framework does is it with the additional powers that it brings, it also brings the complications attached to that, which is why monitoring the budget and the medium-term position is so important.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much for that. Lastly, for me, convener, you mentioned a number of possible levers that might provide us with some sort of flexibility. You've talked about use or otherwise of reserves in your paper. You've talked about capital borrowing powers, and you've even mentioned flexibility around ring-fenced funding and so on. Could you just give us a little flavour of whether these can realistically be deployed, varied or otherwise, to help us through the situation that we're currently in?
Yeah, I'm delighted to do that, and I'll bring Fiona again in a second, just with a bit more detail. So all of those levers are being used currently to support the government's attempts to deliver financial balance in the current financial year. Paragraph 39 to the report, if I've got that the right reference out, has just confirmed the government's attempts to will use the reserves this year to support financial balance. And in terms of some of those wider public sector flexibilities that have existed, the government, Scottish Government and their partners in local government have used some additional flexibility to for some of the reserves in local government bodies, such as councils and integration joint boards, the health and social care authorities, to access some of those reserves to support public sector pay arrangements in local government. These are flexibilities important in the year, but you can only use them once. And I think that is the issue, that it doesn't necessarily provide a template for addressing the financial challenges in the following financial year. But Richard rightly mentioned it already, Mr. Coffey, but it kind of led us to the point in the future part of this paper about actually to secure the financial balance and health of public sector finances and service delivery, that is more of a focus on what reform might now look like, which will ultimately be the most important lever that government will have to deliver high quality, fiscally sustainable public services.
Mm-hmm. The deployment of these levers are in no way that they're sufficient to get us to where we want to be. They're helpful, but they're in no way sufficient to overcome the difficulties that are already in here.
I think the issue, I think they'll help you overcome once, if they are sufficient in their scale to do so. Given that we already have some unresolved public sector pay arrangements, once you've used it, that won't be a source to go back to. Mm-hmm. But it won't address some of the very significant challenges and resultant prioritisation that government, local and central government, will have to take to secure high quality services and fiscal balance.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Thank you, convener.
Thanks. As a supplement to that line of questioning, Craig Hoy's got a question in this area. Craig.
Thanks, Gavina. Good morning, Mr. Ball. Just to take up the point in relation to local government flexibilities and ring fencing, obviously when the UK government hands the consequentials to the Scottish government, it comes with no strings attached and very little in the way of hypothecation, other than I think some elements in relation to national insurance contributions. But when that money then flows to councils, it is... there is a significant degree of ring fencing. That flexibility that you've identified in year this year, given that the cost of living crisis and the pressures that we see are likely to last into next year and possibly the following year, would we expect to see greater flexibility being given to councils in relation to their budgets? And is that something that would be desirable at this point in time?
I think this fundamentally is a policy choice for central and local government to agree through the flow of funds from central to local government. We've commented in previous papers, particularly around COVID spending, for example, that some of the requirements on public bodies, local government and some others, that were eased for public bodies to spend as they saw fit to deliver services. As we've just touched on, some of the ring fencing arrangements have also been reduced to access financial resources to support public sector pay deals. Whether that acts as a template for how the fiscal relationship between central government and local government in years to come, I think will need to be an informed choice that both parties make and understand what the implications of doing so are and not doing so be, because earmarking in its purest sense is designed to ensure that the money is spent with the specific policy intent. As you'll know well, Mr. Hoy, that there's been swings about the extent to which local government budgets have been earmarked over time, but in doing so, it restricts some of the kind of wider choices and flexibility that might be required.
Yeah. And just in relation, obviously, I think you referred earlier to IJBs, that the briefing states that the Scottish Government has requested that some funding which is currently allocated for COVID-19 in IJB reserves can now be used for wider COVID-19 purposes. Is it appropriate for the Scottish Government to seek to influence how integration authorities use their reserves? And do you have any examples of the way in which that money is then being used in other areas?
I'll bring colleagues in if they wish to add. In terms of the appropriateness of it, This has been a matter of discussion between the Scottish Government and their local government partners, COSLA, I think, specifically exploring the possibility of whether this could be a source to support public sector pay deals. I mean, and looking at the scale of challenge that existed in terms of meeting that requirement, I think it is fair to explore whether monies that were originally intended for COVID monies were still required to be spent in that way. If that was deemed not to be the case, then using that money to address other fiscal pressures will have been the reason why they arrived at that point. Your point, really, effectively exploring the opportunity cost, does that mean that there has been a reduction in a COVID service? Those choices will have to be weighed up really clearly, okay, and again in the future, if that's the case. I'll bring colleagues in if they wish, if there's any detail that we have about the use of that money beyond pay deals.
I don't have any of the details. I think one of the things that really which we bring through in probably part one of the paper most is that the sense that there are now multiple challenges which the public sector has to deal with altogether. Mm-hmm. So the pre-existing challenges in terms of financial sustainability, paired with what we've seen over COVID-19 and the recovery from that and the backlog, paired with the cost crisis, mm-hmm, and at the same time the importance of maintaining that long-term view and that view of preventative measures. So the extent to which there are flexibilities within the system to manage those things together is a policy decision, but that's the context in which that's set.
Thanks Richard.
Okay, thank you. Can I just move things on in another area? And that is that you'll not be surprised to learn that I was drawn very much, Auditor General, to paragraph 42, in which you spell out once again, there remains a need for a public consolidated account to provide a comprehensive and transparent assessment of the state of Scotland's public finances. This has been something of a mission of yours and the Public Audit Committee to try to get to. Could you perhaps let us know what progress, as you understand it, is being made in the attainment of that?
Yes, it has been a long-standing conversation between the committee, myself, my predecessor, and the Scottish Government on the need for and the progress that the government is making on this. I should say that my report, my Section 22 report on the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts for 21-22 will be published later this afternoon when the government lays their accounts. I go into quite a bit of detail on the progress that the government is making therein. But without preempting that, it's a yet an unfulfilled delivery requirement, convener. And I say more in the paper about some of the circumstances as to why that is the case. Its absence, though, is a barrier to informing government, informing Parliament of some of the choices that will lead to better public sector reform. That it doesn't have that complete picture, totality of assets, liabilities, that will lead to those better choices on reform. And I think one of the risks, and I'm happy to go into more detail as you wish, is that public sector reform will be done on a piecemeal basis rather than having a view across Scotland as to assets, liabilities. But as yet, unfortunately, we do not have the complete public sector accounts that the committee and auditor generals have called for.
Okay, and do you have any idea when that end point will be reached? Have you had any indication from the permanent secretary or any other part of government about where that lies?
So we have. It is reasonable to say that there has been some progress this year. One of the barriers to it, and again, I'll happy to go into more detail in this when brief the committee soon on the Section 22 report, relates to challenges that in the preparation of whole of government accounts across the UK, that has been delayed this year due to some technical issues within HM Treasury. So it's not entirely at the feet of the Scottish Government that progress has been delayed, but there are requirements to prioritise this, convener. in the greater scheme of things, people say, well, it's another set of public accounts, but actually it will be a key information source to inform policy decisions in the years to come. So we'll continue to look for its completion as quickly as possible.
Thank you. Before we turn to some questions on public sector reform, which Craig Hoy has got, I just wanted to then interrogate a little bit this idea that traditionally there are certain parts of government expenditure which are protected at a time when there is a retrenchment in finances and so on. And I think we've had briefings in Parliament and statements in Parliament about the areas that the government is prioritising. But I just wondered whether in the work that you've been doing in this area, you've detected any sense that within those protected areas, there has been any movement or any shifting of resources between one protected area to another protected area, or within a protected area, or indeed the protections are being reviewed.
We expect you'll see that very clearly through the next budget that will come to Parliament in the next 2 weeks, that there is a clear articulation of those priorities flowing through to budget lines. If I may reference perhaps the Finance and Public Administration's recent report about those priorities also flow to the National Performance Framework and the National Outcomes, that it's clear that budget spending and outcomes, that there's a connection between those. You'll know, Convener, we've not seen that clearly enough thus far. In order to support scrutiny, transparency of public spending, it matters that there's progress on those fronts. Government's priorities, as they set out in the resource spending review on tackling child poverty, climate change, a fairer and greener economy, and delivering excellent public services, are therefore noted, and we expect to see that flow through. In terms of our own work, we've got, we've mentioned adult mental health already. We've further work planned on child poverty. But for the committee's interest, we're also going to be publishing an audit on the Scottish Government's arrangements to manage its climate change ambitions. And that will be coming in the early part of 2023. So alongside spending, there will be scrutiny to support the committee's interest therein.
Thank you very much. And I do want to bring Liz Smith in at some point, but I'm going to turn next to Craig Hoy, and I'll perhaps bring Liz in after that. Craig.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning again, Stephen. Paragraphs 70 and 71, I think, of the briefing were the two that drew media attention. In those, you state that in the face of the financial challenges, the pace and scale of reform needs to increase, and this will require a sense of urgency from the Scottish Government at a time when it is also pressing to resolve short-term issues facing the budget. You go on to say that if this does not happen, it will become increasingly difficult for the Scottish Government to manage the pressures on the budget, meaning that the cuts to spending necessary to balance the budget will become larger, and the quality of public services delivered will worsen. Obviously, to try and move to that point, there has to be some radical action, and that will obviously have to start relatively quickly in terms of the pace and the scale of public sector reform. You'll obviously have seen there was a report of NHS managers discussing some quite radical potential solutions to the problems within the NHS, including potentially charging or scaling back on free prescriptions. Are you aware that are those discussions happening right throughout the public sector? Has the government charged the public sector with the opportunity to go and look radically at the basis on which public services are operating in Scotland?
We've seen from government statements, Mr. Hoy, I think particularly referencing the resource spending review and statements from the Deputy First Minister, that reform is inevitable. You know, it talks about the number of public bodies that we have, the way that public sector services are delivered. Through our own work, through those of my colleagues in the Accounts Commission, we've called regularly for the need for a coordinated programme of public sector reform. Myself and my predecessor have highlighted the unsustainability of health and social care arrangements in Scotland through regular reporting. I'll be publishing my next NHS in Scotland report the end of February 2023. All of these factors point to the need for leaders, both political and officials, to do the kind of thinking that is going to deliver high quality public sector services in the future that are sustainable in fiscal terms as well. So all of these steps are the type of conversations that ought to be happening. It's important, and I think the point to really emphasise on me is that that's not just done on a traditional silo basis from one organisation to the next. Health leaders with local authorities and other public bodies need to have those rounded conversations about how services are going to be delivered. You know, whether it's about the workforce, the estate, the provision of services, sharing of services, all of these factors need to be taken into account so that this is sustainable public sector services in future.
Obviously, you referred to health and social care there, Auditor General. The creation of the National Care Service obviously is attracting significant attention in parliamentary terms and also within the care sector here in Scotland. I think when we discussed this in the past, you said that you wouldn't wait until after the event to provide commentary and critique of the National Care Service. I noted earlier that you said that that there was going to be a balance between short-term necessities and longer-term priorities. Just looking at social care in Scotland at this moment in time and looking at what the government's brought forward in relation to the National Care Service and the financial memorandum that accompanies the bill, do you think that the creation of a National Care Service is a short-term necessity, or should it be put into the category of a longer-term priority, and should we therefore be targeting resource towards the necessity of the crisis in care today?
To refer to a paper that we published not that long ago on social care arrangements, it really speaks to the issues that you described, Mr. Hoy, that we said that there is a short-term crisis facing social care arrangements in Scotland that cannot wait for the creation of a National Care Service to deliver a sustainable level of social care in Scotland. As ever, with whether it's National Care Service or other parts of public sector reform, there will always be a coherent and reasonable argument that says that now's not the time for public sector reform. We're dealing with some very significant challenges. You know, whether it's a cost of living crisis that we're in, whether it's a pandemic, Britain's exit from the European Union, or the fiscal crisis before that, I fear that there'll always be the next crisis that says that we cannot do these things right now. But looking at the scale of public finances currently, if we don't make the kind of radical changes in thinking that we need to, you know, we'll be sitting having these same conversations 3, 5, 10 years from now. And guarding against the risk, I think to repeat if I may, that we don't just do this, you know, one body by the next, by another, that there is a coordinated attempt, leadership from the government that says this is our intent, this is what we will prioritise, and there will have to be those kind of prioritisations. Last point, if I may, just to address the National Care Service point, we did write to the Finance and Public Administration Committee as part of their consideration of evidence in terms of the financial memorandum for the National Care Service, highlighting some of the risks that were clear to us about the scale of numbers set out, about what the National Care Service might cost relative to some of the learning that we've seen from other progress on public sector reform. So all of these things have to be taken into account, both the short term and the longer term reform.
Thanks. Paragraph 72 of the briefing notes that the Scottish Government has set up a new public spending portfolio board and a public spending analytical unit to help drive the required changes and reforms. Are you confident that those organisations will be effective, or could they just further clutter what's already quite a crowded stage?
I'll ask Richard to come in. He's mentioned it this morning already, just to say a bit more detail on it. So I think it's, rather than saying if I'm confident whether they will or won't be effective, I think they have to be effective in order to support effective public sector sustainability and the reform that will need to be delivered to arrive at that point. That, for me, that's the key point, that there is, before Richard comes in, actually, he may wish to kind of, elaborate upon this, that this isn't just done in Victoria Quay or St Andrew's House, that there is actually full transparency, collaboration, involvement of the public in these type of conversations about what public sector services will look like in future, that matters, and that's done in a way that's open and accessible. I'll bring Richard in to say a bit more about how that's intended to work.
Thank you, and Fiona may wish to come in as well, but I think at a broad level, and also maybe again another point to refer back to COVID-19 and what happened over that with the reactive nature of spending. One of the things that was coming through from COVID-19 changes was that need for a collaboration between leadership to work towards shared goals, and also the analytical support to enable them to make that good decisions. So having a public sector sort of public spending portfolio board, which enables that within this context, is reasonable in that sense. One of the things that we found with the COVID-19 was around some difficulties around data and the ability to see spending across portfolios. So again, as things are being prioritised, in the current environment, being able to make those links between the elements of the budget and being able to see how they flow together is going to become increasingly important. So it remains to be seen exactly what the work of the public spending analytical unit will be, and we'll see over time as it develops. But having an analytical capacity to allow better joining up of data and spending across the public sector seems sensible.
Just in relation to the issue about lessons learned from COVID, obviously the COVID pandemic precipitated quite a significant change in the way certain services were delivered, drive-through testing and vaccinations, greater use of digital. Are you picking up that those lessons learned and the capabilities that could bring to future public sector reform are being embraced within and across the public sector?
It was a really strong feature of the pandemic that public bodies set aside some of the traditional decision-making, some might call it bureaucracy, with which public spending and activities were delivered, that public money was spent quickly where it was most needed. And I think, and we've discussed with the committee on a number of occasions, that by and large in Scotland, that was done well. With the we didn't see the level of fraud and error that have been reported in some of the other schemes elsewhere. Has that meant, though, that that's how it currently operates? We've not done any specific work on kind of following through that yet. There is always the risk that, as the pandemic has now eased, that some of the traditional behaviours and ways of working that we saw before the pandemic come back to the fore. Public bodies really have to guard against that. To grasp some of the innovation that we saw and embed that as part of their ways of working. These are the type of behaviours that will result in better public services, that will lead to some of the more the preventative spend, of the principles of Christie that we've spoken about a number of occasions, being embedded and delivering better public services. We continue to monitor and report on some of the behaviours through across all of our annual audit work, and always have the option, Mr Hoy, if that's not been the case, to highlight that through our own statutory reporting to the committee.
Thanks. And just finally and briefly, at page 22 of the briefing states that the public should be fully involved in the key decisions about how public services need to change and are reformed. What evidence have you seen from the Scottish Government and other public bodies that they are engaging the public? And is there perhaps a risk, in just looking and reflecting on the National Care Service, for example, that it's sometimes that there may be a difference of opinion between the public in terms of a stated public policy objective, the creation of a National Care Service, and the actual deliverability and the practical rollout of that? So, for example, we had the Minister today saying the reason we will press ahead with an NCS is that the public supports it. But when you have stakeholders, unions, and the National Health Service and those involved in care saying they don't support the model, is there a risk that sometimes public opinion and the reality on the ground may be divergent?
I think that is a risk for the implementation of any policy, actually, that there will always be those that support it and those that don't. What matters is that public bodies, government, national, local and elsewhere are seen to follow genuine, tried and tested, where appropriate, legislative engagement arrangements, you know, whether it's through that they are following Community Empowerment Act legislation, and being seen to take on views through consultation, actively listening to those contributions. I don't think it will do away from the fact that you're never going to please everybody through any extent of change, but that these are transparent and ultimately the public can see the nature of the change that's proposed and what it costs. I think that probably references back to the contribution that Audit Scotland and others have made in terms of the National Care Service, that the financial memorandum contains risks and that's set out clearly so that the public can understand what that change in terms of service will be, but also what it's going to cost through to its establishment, should that be where we get to.
Thanks very much.
And we've got a few minutes left, so I'm going to invite Liz Smith to put a couple of questions if she's got some. Liz.
Thank you, Convener. Mr Boyle, you said in relation to the Convener's first questions this morning that a very high percentage of the Barnett consequential spend in Scotland on COVID was something that was obviously very important in trying to get us through the pandemic. Can I ask you, how easy is it to track where that COVID spend went? And secondly, are you aware of any unspent COVID money?
I'm happy to start. I'll bring Richard in a second or two. So the first thing I say, we've published a number of reports and papers that set out that Scottish budget and financial reporting system wasn't designed to cope with a fiscal event such as the financial support for COVID. So financial reporting and budget setting tends to be based around departmental budget lines. And of course, COVID spending covered all of these budget lines. So there was a recognition, and through our reporting actually say that there needs to be a gathering up of COVID spending. And to an extent, as the pandemic evolved, the aspects of that happened, and that kind of allowed a broader tracking of what COVID monies were spent. We're finalising some work around that through our own reporting, just to set out for the committee, for Parliament and public attention, here's what our assessment has been of total COVID spending. We'll be publishing that, I think, early into 2023. Overall, there, as we mentioned in the report, Ms Smith, that some COVID monies, as at the end of 2021 and now 2022 financial years, will be held in reserves of whether it's local authorities or integration joint boards. During this financial year, some of that has been reprioritised, no longer deemed necessary for the original intent, and aspects of that used to support public sector pay deals. We hope to give as much clarity as possible on that through our reporting, but it probably illustrates the point where I started, that the budget and financial reporting systems weren't designed to cope with this kind of pandemic or pan-spending style arrangement. And it maybe just speaks to that point that I mentioned already this morning, and I've done so on a number of other occasions, that the public budgeting and spending arrangements they have are quite rigid in terms of departmental arrangements. And encouragement for government's financial reporting that can deploy flexibility to better tease out public spending that links to events and indeed the national outcomes.
That's a very helpful answer, and it's good to hear that there's a paper coming in early 2023 about that. Is it your understanding that for money that is held within councils, let's say in reserves or in IGBs, that some of that money could be used to ease some of the financial pressures that councils are under just now?
I think that's what we've seen through the reallocation of some of those monies to support public sector pay.
Right. So that could help the budget from that angle.
So there's I think a caveat I would add, but up to a point, in discussion with Mr. Coffey earlier, that you can only use it once.
Yeah.
And In reality, the COVID aspect of those reserves is only likely to be a pretty small part.
Yeah.
Most of council's reserves are earmarked for specific purposes before COVID.
Right. So, just have one more question, convener. You mention in paragraph 35, quite rightly, that the Scottish Government has obviously got capital borrowing powers, and that while capital borrowing can't be used to support resource spending, you say that there are certain types of capital spending that could be moved to resource spending. Could I just seek your clarification, Auditor General, on whether there are criteria that govern whether that capital spend can be moved to resources? Are there specific criteria that need to be adhered to for that to happen?
In short, yes, there are criteria that frame the kind of decision-making around capital to resource spending. It's not a typical thing. I think it's safe to say used in fairly specific circumstances. And, you know, and there's quite rightly a separation between capital and resource budgets, about, you know, short-term recurring costs relative to longer-term investments. Richard has a bit more detail and can set that out for the committee.
So the rules we refer to in paragraph 35 are the HM Treasury's consolidated budget guidance. What we do is point out here an example of from what we saw in COVID-19 of how that might apply. So in this particular instance here, what happened was that there was an allowance made for local government to use some of its capital reserves, so from selling use of capital receipts, so from selling buildings or whatever it may be, to meet some of its short-term spending needs on the day-to-day basis. So the reason we highlight that example in particular is while there are some borrowing powers on the capital side, I think it's 450 million yeah. each year is able to be borrowed. If that were to recur, if something like that were to happen again, then as a scenario, the Scottish Government could use its capital borrowing to replace what has been lost.
So that any decision like that has to be set against the HM Treasury criteria?
Yes.
Right. That's very helpful. Thank you.
OK, well, thanks very much indeed. And can I then conclude this session by thanking Fiona Diggle, Richard Robinson and the Auditor General for the time and evidence that you've given us. And there are some areas I think we agreed that it would be useful to follow up and perhaps get back to us on, so we would welcome that as you are able to do that. And I would now like to draw this session of the committee to a close, and we will move into a private session. Thank you.